Hope my screen is visible to all of you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. So welcome to this valedictory function of challenges in adapting machine learning towards 5G and 6G communications. So today we have the valedictory function of this FTP, which has been started. So this was a program which we had starting from the 9th of August. So today is the last day of this particular session. So wherein we had a lot of sessions related to the 5G and 6G communications, the evolution of 5G, and also the application aspects of 5G, where we had a lot of speakers coming from various prestigious institutes who have given us a very good insight into the role of machine learning and adapting the challenges that we have with respect to machine learning in 5G and 6G. So the program schedule is as follows. So we have the keynote address by Chief Guest, Senior Director, Samsung R&D Institute, Mr. Ratnakar Rao, followed by address by Dr. Sandeep Chaturvedi, who happens to be the chapter chair, joint chapter of MTT AP EMC Society, IEEE Hyderabad section. So then we'll take into the feedback of the participants with the concluding remarks. So today we have our Chief Guest, Mr. Ratnakar RV, who is the Senior Director Engineering, Samsung R&D India Bangalore. So his education profile is, he has done his MBA in marketing from the University of Leicester, and he has done his MTech in Telecommunication Systems Engineering, IIT Kharagpur, and his BTech was from Electronics and Communication from Madras University. So coming to his job profile, so he has more than 20 years of experience in telecommunication R&D. He has worked on the development and deployment of 3G, 4G and 5G technologies worldwide. Currently, he is leading Beyond 5G Communication R&D at Samsung Bangalore Center, and he has more than 25 international patent grants, and he also happens to be IEEE senior member. Sir, welcome, sir. Welcome for this valedictory function, and it's over to you, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you for this kind introduction. Thank you very much for making me part of this event. I could see, probably close to 100 plus participants, probably from representing various colleges, various regions are in this program. So it's my pleasure to engage them on a Friday evening. So since this being the last session, probably it's my duty as well as obligation to make it as interesting as possible. So I'll try to share, the topic is very, very relevant. In fact, when I saw the whole theme of this FDP, really, really pleasantly surprised, because not many people are talking about applications of AI and ML in the communication domain. They are widely talked about in the computer vision, speech processing, natural language processing, text processing, data analytics. So in all the other areas, it's widely being talked about in India. But specifically in the area of communication and networks, it's not really being discussed widely in India, but rather it is a hot topic in the academia, actually, worldwide. So it's my pleasure to introduce certain things. Where do we see the scope of AI or ML in the communication domain, and probably share with you some of the latest research results, maybe from my team in Bangalore, and maybe what's happening in the ecosystem. So assuming I have about 45 minutes time, let me see how much I can do justice in this time. Otherwise, I request, feel free to ask questions either in the chat box or towards the end. I'll be happy to answer some questions as well. So let me share my screen. Okay. So I hope my screen is visible to all.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. So I have titled this talk. The topic is, role of AI in beyond 5G terminals and networks. So since I have been working in this area of wireless communication So that is a topic very close to my heart. But of course, many people did question. I mean, in fact, in a previous lecture I gave on this topic, people asked, okay, there is no 5G yet in India. Why are we already talking about beyond 5G? That was the first natural question that arose. So for that, I mean, I always, you know, introduce it with this kind of a picture that for the commercial 5G, so this is actually the third year of commercial 5G services in the, around the world. So yeah, it may be for various reasons, I mean, it may be coming to India soon, but otherwise several countries have already deployed and so many advances have already happened, I mean, in the 5G deployments. Like, for example, the very first deployment happened in USA in the mid-2019, wherein the millimeter wave 5G, as well as the 5G in the sub-6 TDD bands, which is this the 3.5 gigahertz and 2.5 gigahertz bands. So it was successfully deployed, and it's running ever since. And that's where you will see all these news of, 1 Gbps data rate, 2 Gbps data rate. I mean, it's all coming from there. So since then, a lot of things happened. I mean, we already have almost a dozen plus commercial products, not only just the flagship smartphones, but even the tablets, affordable smartphones, all of them capable of 5G worldwide. So the latest advances are actually, I mean, now people are, in fact, ready to give up 4G and go for a 5G standalone mode of operation. So that is also around Q2 2020. I mean, the first 5G standalone commercial network service was launched in USA. And now we are going in the direction of actually 5G carrier aggregation. I mean, can we actually, of course, I mean, it's very funny to talk about a peak data rates because no individual user will need those peak data rates. I mean, if I say, okay, the latest state of the art is you can get, say, 10 Gbps, right? Theoretically, on any given smartphone, it can be proven also. But it's really about the overall capacity of the system. So that capacity is already getting built in a wide fashion. So in that sense, for the research community, so we are already in the beyond 5G era. I mean, we are 3 years past 5G deployed. Now, in fact, people have started discussing, hey, what is the 6G vision? What are the components of 6G, right? What should be the candidate technologies? People have started talking that conceptualizing. And even the 3GPP, which makes all these standards for 4G, 5G, and other communication technologies. So they have already designated the release 18 of 3GPP will be called as 5G advanced, wherein they'll bring in support for a lot of advanced forms of 5G, like maybe satellite communication based 5G, drones, high altitude base stations, ultra reliable and low latency networks. So many things will appear very soon in due course, and maybe in a couple of years. Right? So that's why we are firmly in the beyond 5G era. I mean, that's the intention when we talk about the B5G. So when we talk about the pace of technology, I'm always amazed, I mean, how we underestimate the pace of technology, even in the country, even in our country, right? So that's why I always find it appropriate to start with this reminder that some people in 2016, so they predicted that, this is about India, basically. In India, how much mobile data consumption will happen, right, on a monthly basis. So they saw that, okay, in 2015, the actual measured value is about 150 petabytes per month, right? So somebody thought that, okay, wow, I mean, India mobile data usage will increase. So by 2020, there will be 1700 petabytes of monthly data usage all over India. And people said, okay, that's a fantastic rise. I mean, you saw it, it's almost maybe more than 10 times increase in the data consumption. But the reality, I mean, if you want to see the reality, like what is the real numbers that got measured at the end of 2020? What is India consuming as a mobile data? That comes in this report. So if you see this top bar, 9,762 petabytes per month. That is the actual real data consumption measured in December 2020. So now you can imagine, I mean, where is 1700 petabytes and where is 9762 petabytes? That's actually probably, I don't know, so many times disproportionately higher than the original estimate. So this is the power of technological evolutionary advance, basically. So what we really assume, in reality, things will happen much more faster than we assume. Right? So my belief is that same thing is happening to this AI and ML. So we are talking probably as if it's, you know, it will happen future. But that future is happening very fast, probably right in front of our eyes. So that's why we all should really, whatever research we are doing or whatever projects we are doing, we should really all speed up, actually, because otherwise the overall change of the ecosystem will be much faster. So that's the thought I wanted to leave on this slide. So when I looked around, actually, we are all talking about AI in communication networks as if it's happening in future, right? So I saw, is there anything really happening right now? That's when I realized there are actually fantastic initiatives already happening, like GSMA. GSMA is the association of all the GSM players around the world, right? The 3GPP, all the telcos, OEMs, they're all members of this association. So GSMA has actually created an initiative called AI for Impact Initiative, which is basically effectively mining the carrier data. The telecom carriers are there in every country, right? So mining the big data available with them and using that insights to dictate the COVID-19 response by the governments. So of course, we really don't know whether Indian carriers are part of this initiative. That information is not available. But at least in a lot of low and middle income countries, so GSMA has claimed that they're able to do all this, basically. They're able to track the population migration because, as you can imagine, right, the operator data can clearly tell, basically, okay, how many users are actually in this particular location and how many were here yesterday and how many are there today and where did they go from here to there. I mean, because based on your location records, everything is available to the telecom operators. The data is available. So really, where are people migrating from one area to another area because of whatever COVID lockdowns or other reasons? And who are the vulnerable population groups? And are the lockdowns effective, basically? How many people are still going to a particular location which is supposed to be in lockdown, right? And also, where to send the resources? Like, okay, now I have this, all these medical supplies, I have these things. So where should I send to? So all these use cases were actually addressed by them. And they assisted at least a dozen plus governments with the help of telecom carriers' data. So that really shows the power that the already existing data is holding. So, of course, once the data is available, so now all these telecom carriers, they're having data, right? Like at what time you power on your device, how many calls you make, what sessions, how much data you use, which application do you use. Everything is actually visible to the service providers. And by the way, of course, so GSMA has actually taken extreme precautions to make it completely anonymized and randomized. I mean, so there is it's a effective undertaking. I mean, otherwise it's a big security and privacy nightmare, right? So all those were taken care. I mean, so that we should assume that are inherently taken care. But the once you have this kind of data, you can always use it to describe the picture. Oh, this happened, as if it's happened in the past to understand what happened, right? What happened to people? I mean, where are the resources going? Which sector is hit, right? Which industries are working and which is not working? All kinds of data can be described. But once you really fit a AI model with this data, right? Maybe you'll be able to start predicting basically what will happen now, what will happen. So where should I, instead of sending my resources, my medicines or my supplies to this location, if I can predict that, no, next big thing will happen here, so you should be actually focusing on somewhere else, right? So that can be done. So it will become predictive in nature the moment we apply all the ML and AI models on top of this data. So that's as simple as that. That can be done with the available data. So in that sense, this is not any new effort. So I'm not yet really gone to, you know, the 5G or the 6G aspects of it. This is just as it is today, what can be done. This is an example of that, what is already happening. So now we just take a, let's take a peek at, you know, what do we mean by this beyond 5G network and terminals? I mean, why is it so different? I mean, what is so complex about that? I mean, why can't we do it the way we are doing now, right? So this is one picture which I have taken. I mean, the reference is mentioned there. It's an IEEE Access Journal picture. It nicely shows, I mean, a lot of things that will form the part of a beyond 5G network. So you can see on one side, I mean, you have this V2X, vehicle-to-vehicle communication. Vehicles are communicating to each other. They are communicating to roadside units, right? And then you have devices communicating to device to device. And then you have edge computing as well as cloud computing. And then you have your base stations on a higher altitude, like your drone might be a base station. It might provide a temporary cellular coverage, you know, in remote areas by just sending a drone with a base station. So there can be even higher altitude base stations, which can be, you know, mounted on satellites. And then there will be machine type communication where it's not people who are using, it's all machines that are using. And then even the devices, as you can see, it can have multi-access connectivity. Like even today we have this choice, right? Like if you have a smartphone at home, you can connect it to the mobile network or you can connect it to your home Wi-Fi, right? But now the choices will multiply once you have a 5G millimeter wave deployment. So you have a 5G millimeter wave, 5G sub-6, you have 4G, you have Wi-Fi, and you might have some device to device. So it becomes a multi-access connectivity. So these are all the various facets of the future network. And the complexity arises because most of the time, one network should handle all these use cases. Likewise, one terminal should support all these use cases. That is the challenge. So that is why, I mean, when we talk about, okay, what is so different in the beyond 5G networks and terminals? So I think this picture serves as a good example, overview. I mean, probably there could be many other things that are missing, but this serves as a reminder that, oh, I mean, if one device has to support all these functions, if one network has to support all these functions, it's not a easy thing. I mean, you definitely need to incorporate a lot more complexity. So that's why we'll go in. I mean that, okay, the traditional rule-based approaches may need to give way for more complex approaches based on machine learning, right? So this slide is to show some of the traditional directions. I mean, like as in, these are not really, I would say, of course, these are evergreen areas for research, but these are not the recent advances. These kind of thoughts are there even before. Like, for example, like any commercial network, right? Like even today, we suffer if our home broadband goes down even for a few minutes, right? But if you imagine all your mobile networks, they cannot have any downtime. I mean, the downtime has to be extremely, extremely, extremely rare situation. So for the whole infra to stay like that, right now, that same infra is supporting cars, same infra is supporting devices, same infra is supporting smart factories. So you really cannot afford any downtime. So folks have always been asking, basically, so hey, without human intervention, without me sending a technician, can I detect a fault automatically by sitting remotely in my control center? I am sitting in my control center. Can I find out which network node is creating this problem? Right, fault detection. So that is already there in most of the networks today, be it home broadband or in the wireless networks. Fault detection is pretty much now automated. You should be able to localize your fault. But then people said, hey, I mean, I can I predict it ahead of time? I mean, What's the fun in detecting and then rectifying? I already have my downtime. But if I can predict that, okay, this particular node is failing because of this situations, right? Or this particular issue with say some call drops or some voice mute, whatever may be the thing, is happening when so-and-so conditions prevail. So based on that, if my network can predict and do something in advance, right, then recovery is possible even before the fault happens. So that's why it is very, very high on the, telecom service providers list of AI directions. And main thing is, once this is all automated, I mean, it will reduce their operational expenses heavily. I mean, you don't need to really have an army of people, to manage your network. You'll be able to manage it with your simple software dashboard, right? So that's the biggest motivation. Yeah? As you can see this graph actually, what are the top reasons why mobile network operators, want an AI-assisted network automation? The top reason is operational expenses. They want to cut down their expenses. And the second is improve the customer's quality of experience. Right? That comes secondary, but that's also equally important. So this will ensure that if you're predicting the faults ahead and recovering, so then the user's experience of the network will be much, much better. So network security, this also has been an important area wherein people are trying to, now can we detect the threats as they emerge and then do something ahead of time? Can we block the malicious applications? Can we block the malicious data collections? Right? So all those things, they're all the, again, the traditional direction, application of AI, do it, automatically. Then network planning. Again, these days, if you have to deploy a cell in any new location, right? So it should not take a lot of time. Okay, hey, I need to plan the terrain. This is my network planning. This is the power level. This is the link budget. This is how I'll do the RF planning. This is how I'll avoid the interference. If all those has to be done manually on a paper or using any mathematical tool, it will be very, very painful and a costly and a delayed process. So that's why for network planning, as well as for self-optimizing networks. So definitely these four areas, AI is happening, will happen. There's no doubt. That is a sure shot direction. So if anybody has to work on problem statements that are sure to happen, then these are those areas. Probably we'll see a couple of examples, how certain carriers are using this. So this is one of a typical example. What the telcos can do when we say, okay, they can apply AI-based data analytics. So even today, all networks are actually equipped to understand all this. They have all this data in their network somewhere, right? Something could be at the base station, something could be in the core network, something could be in the backhaul, but it is there somewhere, right? So people can today say, if you are in a voice call on your mobile network, and if there are mutes or breaks in the voice, so it's actually possible to monitor. Hey, some packets are getting lost. The jitter, is greater than the voice packet frequency, right? So like that, it is possible to see this on the network. So likewise, if you're watching any videos, it's very common, right? The buffering experiences, data stalls, those things are also possible to monitor. The information is available at the network. And then the cell optimization, as I mentioned, if you have deployed a new tower or a new cell, is it interfering with the nearby towers? Are the nearby towers interfering with this cell? Are the parameters configured for a smooth handover? If somebody is driving across or walking across this tower to that tower, right? The coverage, is it contiguous? Are the parameters optimized for the mobility? So all these things, they can be actually collected because the information is available in bits and pieces. And then if we apply predictive analytics on top of that, then we should be able to address some of those things ahead of time. Like, for example, the moment we see that, okay, cell configuration is bad, it's having lot of interference, for example, then probably we should do some load balancing. I mean, the all the users loading that cell, creating the interference, they should be offloaded to other cells. So likewise, particularly, for example, if the voice traffic is getting a lot of disturbance, then probably we need to increase the priority for all the voice bearers and reduce the priority for some data bearers. So like that, I mean, the decisions based on predictive analytics can be taken so that the quality of experience for users will improve tremendously. And the benefit for operators, as we discussed, I mean, their operational cost reduces, and then naturally the service uptime will be much, much better. So this is typically how the sequence looks like, right? So this is a traditional direction. As I mentioned, this is anyway happening. In fact, this is the sure thing to happen. So the second big thing, I mean, which probably I'm sure it was covered in the previous sessions on 5G, or if you would have read elsewhere in the literature. So one of the biggest changes that's happening in the 5G standards or the 5G deployments is what is called as the openness of the network elements. So what the people did is, when they're defining the standards, so earlier standard is a very huge monolithic block, you know, it has to come from, it's all in specialized hardware. So that is the way past networks are built. But now you might have heard this word, I mean, you know, SDNs and the NFV, network feature virtualization. So the network, one big monolithic network, is actually broken. I mean, in the technical jargon, it's called as disaggregation. So the core network and RAN, they are broken. The user plane and the control plane, they are broken. Right? The radio unit and the distributed unit, they are broken. So now these pieces can be deployed anywhere in the cloud. I mean, they don't need a specific hardware. They can be deployed in a general purpose hardware, and they can be deployed in the cloud because the interfaces between them are made open. Right? It's an open standard between one block and another block. So this way, naturally, I mean, the network became much more scalable, because now I can decide, hey, I need 10 blocks of this and five blocks of this, right? But it also made it easier for anybody to develop, basically. Like, I can develop this block, I can buy this block from somebody else, I can buy the third block from somebody else, right? It becomes an open interface-based network deployment. But in such a scenario, you'd have heard the key concept of 5G is actually network slicing, that the same network has to offer a low latency response, a guaranteed low latency response to certain services. And of course, it can be an emergency service, or it can be an interactive game. You might be playing a real-time gaming, right? And for some other applications, maybe latency is tolerable, but network has to guarantee a certain throughput. Like, for example, if you're doing a VR streaming, so VR streaming expects you have to guarantee whatever 50 megabits or 100 megabits per second of data. It cannot go down below that. So how can the same network manage all this? So that's where is this concept of network slicing. I mean, it's a huge topic on its own. I'm sure, I mean, if you search in the net, you will find out. So now this dynamic scaling up or scaling down of network resources, right? That's not a easy or a trivial job. There needs to be a lot of intelligence there, right? That's because, depending on, say, now I have opened my mobile, I started watching a video, right? Probably I'll be using some slice one, which is a guaranteed throughput slice. So network thinks that, okay, it's okay. I mean, you don't mind latencies. So it will not activate any edge resources for you. I mean, you need to go all the way till your, you know, the core data center, the latency will be longer, but you will be getting your certain minimum data rate. But the moment I switch to an interactive game, I start playing a game which needs a very, very low latency response, right? So then it needs to me to move to a different slice. And for that, the network has to offer me resources which are closer to me, which is what is this, you know, mobile edge computing, what they call. So now I need the resources to be there, and I need my latency to be guaranteed. So now such things to manage across millions of users. If one user, it's fine. I mean, I can make a rule-based approach. But now I'm talking about cloud resources, thousands of applications and millions of users. So I need something called as this RAN intelligent controller. It's an intelligent module. In fact, we recently demonstrated this, that to really make network slicing possible in a commercial scale, you actually need an intelligent controller to do this. Otherwise, the RAN resource management is not possible by following the traditional techniques. And this RAN intelligent controller is completely, I mean, as the word says, intelligent. I mean, it has to be implemented based on the traffic patterns, user requirements, the resource availability. So you have a lot of analytical as well as predictive things to be done there, that RAN intelligent controller. So this is also already in a way happening, I mean, happening in the 5G era itself to make the network slicing realistic. These are the examples I mentioned. I mean, this is a couple of examples. This is what's happening in China, actually. So Chinese telcos are actually using AI extensively in the network management. Like, there's an example where you can see, I mean, they have in fact great plans that they want to collect the data from the terminal, from the network, and create a big data lake, right? It sounds scary for the privacy point of view, but I'm sure, I mean, there will be protections and all those things on top of that. So once that big data lake is available, they want to actually open up certain APIs for the application developers, right? Or even they can open up APIs for the government or for the banks, for the financial reasons or for the safety reasons, security, whatever reasons, they can open up APIs. So that using that APIs, the application guys can make use of this power of this data collected by the telecom operator. And the operator themselves can use it for the smart purposes like this. Like here you can see, this is kind of a typical, you know, load balancing. Like if too many UEs, too many mobiles, or congesting a particular cell, you need to quickly balance it out. Otherwise, that cell will be burdened and no user will get any decent data rate, right? So you can see the difference. I mean, the red line without using AI, right? And the amber line with using AI. So the red line is simply not able to manage basically each UE unless it sends some 15, 20, 30 measurement reports. Nobody is caring about that. The traditional way is not even working. Whereas an AI-based approach, always at max, you need a 5 measurement reports. By then you're already taken care. You're already balanced into a better cell than what you are currently. Right? So there are several use cases. Again, I have given this reference here, AI and network use cases in China. It's published by GSMA. So it has a lot more use cases how they are extensively using this AI on the network management purposes. But now, so this is where is the, I want to just shift the focus basically, because I'm assuming, see, most of us are all communication people. We might be working on physical layer, we might be working on RF, MAC, right? Data networking, network layer, all these kind of areas. So what about those areas? I mean, do we see really there is scope for AI or ML, or is it purely only for network management purposes? Or is it only purely for the analytics based, you know, big data collection analytics, and then based on some actions? So that's why if we take a close look at some of the other network functions, right? For example, channel selection, right? If you have to estimate your channel, right, at your physical layer, which channel model will you use to estimate it, right? Do you use a dense urban, do you use rural, sparse urban, which kind of channel you should select to decode, right? And imagine for the network, basically, now I have resources, I have this time frequency resources to allocate to you based on using the OFDM technique, right? So which resource block should I allocate to which user at a given point of time? Request transmit power, like for example, what should be my initial transmit power? Should I shout it at say 10 dBm? Will the network be able to hear me? Should I do it at 25 dBm? What should be my transmit power, right? Same dilemma, choice for both the network as well as the terminal, right? Like a base station selection for handover. Like for example, now I'm a mobile user. I'm walking or I'm driving. So I can see, my mobile can see three towers. I'm reporting three towers to the network. So my call should be handed over to which base station so that the call stays without dropping. So likewise, there are several of these decisions at a physical layer, MAC layer, radio resource management layer, transport layer, network layer, right? So all these, if you observe, they're all actually problems of, you know, decision making. Like for example, right, should I transmit to this user? Should I transmit to that user? Should I transmit at 25 dBm? Should I transmit at 10 dBm? Or should I select to this handover, or should I select, should I hand over to this base station or that base station? So all these are classical decision-making problems or classification problems, right? And your channel estimation, if you imagine closely, are the, you know, your equalizers and all those modules, they're all effectively regression problems. How closely you can regress to the actual channel condition, right? And effectively, each of these decisions can be actually based on some kind of a reinforcement learning, right? So reinforcement learning is basically, hey, last time I allocated this resource block to this user, but he got a CRC error. So I know that I should do something else for this user, right? But if I do the same thing repeatedly again and again, then I'm wasting my network capacity. Likewise, same thing. I know that last time when I transmitted at 10 dBm, the receiver is not able to receive it. I mean, it's lost. So because of, based on the power control, I'm stepping up 10 to 12 dBm, 12 to 14, 14 to 16. And finally, when I reach 20, the network is able to hear me, right? So then should I delay so longer? Can't I start with 20? Right? So likewise, base station for handover. I mean, last time when I handed over to this tower, my call dropped. So even though this is showing a better whatever signal SNR, for whatever reason, this cell is more congested. So can I hand over to this cell, right? So like that, if networks and terminals learn from their previous decisions, take an action and see what happens. If it's benefiting your, if it's rewarding, meaning either it's increasing you, it is giving you low latency, it's increasing your capacity, it's giving you a higher data rate, it's reducing the call drops, call setup failures, whatever might be the reward you're looking for. So if it helps, do it again. If it's not helping, don't do it. Simple. That's how the reinforcement learning works, right? And if you fit a deep learning model on top of that, the DRL, deep reinforcement learning, then you can actually take in a lot more non-linearities into your models. So theoretically, on that basis, ideally, all these problems, right from the physical layer, channel selection, transmit power selection, to the MAC decisions on the transmit power scheduling, on the power control schemes. So at that level, and to the RRM, the radio resource management, which user should be scheduled when. So all these things can actually be, at least theoretically, be based on the AI and ML models. Because as we have just now established, they're all essentially classification problems or regression problems, and they all can benefit from reinforcement learning approaches. So that's one key takeaway before we go and say that, hey, I want to apply AI for my lower layers also. So that is the starting point. Just agreeing that they're all classification problems, which is what your neural networks do, right? I mean, they either classify, they're either analytical or predictive in nature. Right? Now, I want to show you a couple of examples of, papers published by by our team as well. So the channel estimation problem. So what happened is, if you see the typical channel response, right? I'm assuming, I mean, we have a lot of communication folks on the call also. So the channel response looks like this, right? It's a frequency time variant channel, time frequency variant channel. So the areas you're seeing as red are the stronger, channel energies. And the areas as you see a dip, that means, I mean, the channel is responding badly there, right? So your channel estimation is effectively how closely you can get this picture. Because if I can get this picture accurately, that means I have estimated my channel perfectly, right? That's the challenge. So there are researchers, I mean, that's why this research is from actually from a different set of people, Sultani and co. So they approached it, hey, can I treat this as an image processing problem, right? So I'm sure we have some image processing people also on the call. So what they said is, you know, in a typical communication system, we anyway have pilot symbols, right? You will be in the time frequency horizon, in the time frequency grid. There will be pilot symbols occupying certain positions. So typically you see the pilots and try to estimate the channel conditions around those pilots. Right? That's what you do in the regular communication receivers, right? Your channel estimation. So they saw this and they said, hey, this is similar to my image processing problem of improving the resolution. If you give me a low resolution image, right, I can generate a high resolution image out of that. These techniques we also see, right, even our TVs and all, for example, the smart TVs. So if you give a low resolution stream, they can actually enhance it to show you a high resolution picture, right? So they already had a neural network called super resolution network, SRNet, right? So they use that. And then there are already techniques in image processing which talk about image restoration. When you give a partially faded out image, you can restore a very good image out of that, right? So they took these two networks, the super resolution network and the image restoration network, the neural nets which are already available, and tried to apply that to this channel estimation problem. And they reported really fantastic results. They showed that by applying these neural nets, the kind of channel estimation accuracy we are getting is better than the traditional communication receiver schemes, where we use our, you know, our max likelihood or MMSE receivers typically, right? So they are beating the performance of those schemes by using a neural net. So that's the first enlightened. I mean, we thought that, wow, I mean, this is very, very exciting now. So that means we can actually go and apply deep learning for a physical layer problem. But then we realized if we really have to implement these models in a smartphone or in any smaller device, because we don't have a supercomputer in hand, right? So the complexity, both in terms of the processing as well as memory, it has to be very, very minimal, manageable, right? So that is point one. And point two, naturally, all the communication guys, right? And I'm sure all the communication guys should feel very, very offended. Hey, what's this? I mean, if without the knowledge of any communication guy, if you can just purely apply a model and estimate a channel, I mean, then what's my role? I mean, what am I doing, right? So this research, I mean, was improvised by our people. So what they did is, okay, they took the similar channel models and they applied some expert knowledge. Like, what do we know as communication engineers? What do we know about this channel? So we realized that, okay, you know, we know that this channel is having certain pilot symbols, and also this channel is influenced by intra-symbol interference in the time domain and the Doppler effect in the frequency domain. So we tried to separate it out. So we said that, okay, let's tackle this separately. So we implemented neural nets to first denoise the pilots, and then using that, try to interpolate in time domain and frequency domain separately. So in time domain, we are first neutralizing the inter-symbol interference, and in frequency domain, we are neutralizing the Doppler effect. and then take the resulting channel response. So then we saw beautiful results. Naturally, we also, our results also are better than the traditional LMMSE results, right? And our results are also probably a little better than what Soltani and Co. has showed in the previous slide, right? But the most important aspect of our result is the model which we created is actually 1,000 times less complex and needs only 1% of the memory compared to ChannelNet. So that means you're able to get same level of accuracy at 1,000 less complexity and 1% of the memory complexity. So this is the beauty. So ideally, if the communication experts can go and take these available techniques in the AI/ML world and try to apply their expert knowledge and optimize them for the communication problems, then we can see a lot more beautiful results actually. So there's a testimony of that. So I just want to share, and anyway, the reference is there in case if you want to see the paper, it's getting published in this 2021 WCNC conference. So another higher layer example, maybe like, for example, we discussed this problem wherein, you know, I have to change from this tower to that tower while I'm in mobility, right? And many times if that handover is not optimal, if it's not happening at the right instant, you will see some problem. Either your call will drop if you're on a call, or on the data, you'll see some data stall, your data rate will dip and then it has to recover. Certain things will happen. So how to avoid that, right? So that's where, again, our folks have experimented with the two kind of neural nets. One is using a RNN and the other is using LSTM. That can we learn whether this handover will succeed or fail based on what happened in the past, right? That's where the LSTM will be helpful. And if we predict, if we forecast that this handover is going to fail, then what can be done in advance? So we realize that, okay, if we can do something, say if we can send the measurement report to the network, say 200 milliseconds ahead of time, 200 milliseconds, that means fraction of a second, then the call can be saved. It can be handed over in time to a better network, right? So those kind of experiments also happened, and we published those results also. So this is just to give you a couple of examples that how, what are the possibilities of applying AI and ML, not only for the network analytics or network management, but even at the RF, physical layer, MAC layer, network layer in those areas. Those are the examples. So this is the eventual Samsung vision for the next generation communication system, which is the 6G. So again, if you search in the net, you will find out a 6G vision white paper published by our departments at Samsung Research. So eventually we visualize for the 6G era, it has to be a comprehensive AI. That means there has to be some AI which is working locally in each of the network element, something working in the UE, something in the base station, something in the core network, without the knowledge of each other. I mean, I'm doing my job, you do your job. I mean, we don't need to know each other. That it's AI based or it's a traditional model based. But there will be another level of AI which has to be joint. Like, for example, this kind of handover or mobility, these kind of decisions, maybe they have to be collaborative. Both the AI models on the network and the device, they need to talk and do something, right? That's a joint AI. And for certain things, especially the application experience, right, or for the security kind of use cases, the AI has to work end to end basically. So it's not limited to any particular element or any set of subset of elements. It has to be end to end. So that's why the vision is for an end to end AI. So in that sense, each and every element of the network and terminal has a scope to modify. So this is not just Samsung. This is just to give you the example, basically. So there are already literature showing that, hey, what kind of models and what are the use cases where you can apply AI, right? For example, the first one is a table from an IEEE magazine that what can you do at physical layer? What can you do at data link? What can you do at network layer? And the bottom right hand side is a reference from the latest IEEE communication magazine, probably a couple of months back, that what Nokia Bell Labs is proposing. Nokia Bell Labs is saying that, hey, eventually for 6G time, we have to replace both transmitter and receiver with ML-based TX-RX. So that means completely moving away from the model-based approach to data-driven approach. So that's a vision. I mean, they are working on that. So in that sense, there is this general underlying trend happening in the ecosystem. That's my intention to show these things. So whereas now I think I know I'm a little bit exceeding my time. So let me try to quickly wrap it up. So there are certain standard bodies which are working on, you know, same thing. I mean, of course, they're all working on still the network management aspect only. They are not yet talking about most of the advanced researches what we talked about, which is at the physical RF, MAC, and network layers. Right? That is still at a research stage, I would say. Right? Whereas if standards are discussing these topics, means they are much more closer to realization. That means these are anyway going to happen. So then, again, we all know, I mean, why is this sudden rush? I mean, what changed now? Why is everybody interested in AI and ML? So I think the top reason is the main, basically. Now the memory and the computation even available on a device, like a lot of the flagship devices, like Samsung's devices, for example, they actually come with a neural processor on board, actually. If you want to do any neural processing, there is an NPU available on board. So likewise, with all these edge computing, cloud computing, literally the memory and the computation has become cheaper. That is the main driver. And all the other points, I mean, we talked in the past, I mean, that network features are getting virtualized. Operators want to reduce the operational expenses. And the next generation networks are very, very complex. So it's a multivariate time variant system. So you need a better scheme to capture all these nonlinearities. So probably we're on the penultimate slide. This is very, very important. So just to separate out the hype and the reality, because there is a constant debate, even in the, both in the industry as well as in the academia, this debate is going on. There are certain pure communication people who ask, why do we need this AI and ML for the lower layers? We are happily, successfully launched 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G. They're all successful technologies. So why do we need to do differently for 6G, right? That's where folks like us are saying, basically, see, you need it because your mathematical models or statistical models are not accurate, whereas an ML or a deep learning based model will be able to become more accurate. I mean, it'll be able to regress more better. And it's computationally efficient. I showed you the example, right? We're using our approach, we're able to reduce the computation as well as the memory. And there'll be lesser control overheads, because if it's a rule based, there'll be a lot of signaling between various network elements. But if it's all intelligent, then you don't need to exchange much, right? The control overheads are lower. But there are drawbacks for the machine learning based approaches. There are no doubt. First is, you know, your ML or AI models are all based on how much data you use to train the model, right? So if really it cannot give you any guarantee, basically the moment it sees a data which has not seen before, it can completely break, the model can break. So there is no performance guarantee, unlike your mathematical model or statistical model offers. And then second, if something goes wrong with the system, it's very, very difficult to debug, because the AI models are these neural networks. When all you see is some intermediate states, if you really want to debug something, I mean, they are not like any mathematical model where you tweak some parameters and you try to, you know, change the performance. So these two are the drawbacks. So that's why the bottom line is, see, we are not trying to hype up and say that, hey, I mean, you have to take AI ML everywhere from RF to the application layer. No, it will not be eventually. But we need to do a lot of research and experiments to identify where it is applicable and where it is not. So that is the stage where we are in right now. So in that sense, probably for all of you in the research ecosystem, in terms of doing the projects and all, there are a lot of projects that can be executed in this area, because a lot of experimentation is needed. So since of course the theme of your workshop itself is what are the challenges, as I mentioned, data, I mean, where do you get this data? In case of computer vision, there are databases of images available, right? So if you need to train to detect one cat, I mean, you have pictures of 1000 cats. You learn and you say, okay, this is a cat, right? But how do I do that for a channel model, right? So where do we get this data from? So that's the biggest challenge. So there are several approaches. People say, okay, no, you need to create or simulate it using your GAN. That will give you the data. Use that data to train your neural network. Some people say, no, start capturing from all the live networks and make it okay, open source, federated learning. A lot of approaches are provided, but availability of data sets is the biggest challenge. And second, the latency requirement, because the complex models cannot be executed on any particular node. Like I cannot do everything on my terminal, or everything cannot happen on a particular base station. So it means if multiple entities are involved, like my edge computing, my core network, and my mobile, the latencies have to be guaranteed. If the latencies are not guaranteed, then the model will not perform. So these are the biggest challenges. So on that note, maybe I would like to, end my talk. And I hope maybe I was able to make some points which you can take away and maybe research further or look further. Thank you very much. And if there are any questions, I can answer them, or we can go to the next section.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for elaborately explaining us the things about AI, the role of AI in predictive analysis, and also the role of at each and every point. As you said, ecosystem is much faster. So we as faculty are also trying to gear up to all these areas of research by attending such kind of sessions. And especially, it's a great insight for us from a person coming from the industry, especially from Samsung R&D. And clearly, you have shown us a lot of use cases probably, which can be a point of research for all of us also. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for being part of this session today.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
So this is a token of gratitude for taking part in this FDP, sir. Thank you so much, Ratnakar, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Ratnakar, sir. So you have to visit VNR Vidya and Jyoti. So we wish this pandemic will go away from our country. So I want to see you in our campus, so that VNR, VJIT and Samsung collaboratively we can do some projects which are useful to the society. So I need your support, so that with the help of our faculty and students, we can do something which is useful to the society, sir. Thank you.
Look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir, for spending your valuable time on Friday evening. So, sir is the director of advancement, sir.
Thank you, Ratnakar Rao, sir. I think you have given wonderful speech. So definitely, I think our faculty and all the delegates, I think they're going to take away from this lecture. Sir, actually, we are looking for R&D, sir. Especially, we have nearly 15 faculty with PhD qualifications. Another, I think, 25 faculty, they're pursuing PhD also, sir. So a lot of, scope is there for R&D, especially in case of electronics and communication. So in this direction, I think we request your cooperation and see that, sir, at least we need some help from your side to take up R&D, especially in case of communication systems, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. And this year, we're going to start MTech program in defense technologies also, sir, with 18 students. So there also, we have taken only communications and sensor technologies, sir. So thank you.
Nice to hear. Thank you. Sir. Thank you very much. Thank you,
sir. Over to Ansuta, madam.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Director, sir, for those nice words about Ratnakar sir, and thanks to Ratnakar sir again from all the FDP coordinators and organizing team for being part of this FDP. So next I would like to continue with our next guest of honor, who is Dr. Sandeep Chaturvedi. He is the Deputy General Manager, head MMIC Design Center, Gallium Arsenide Enabling Technology Center, which is also called as GATEC. So coming to the profile of Dr. Sandeep Chaturvedi, so he has done his PhD in Microwave Engineering from IIT Delhi. So he has done his MSc Electronics from Dr. Har Singh Gaur University, Sagar, and he is also recipient of Gaur Samman for securing the first rank in the Faculty of Engineering Sciences in his university. So he has done his BSc Electronics from APS University, Rewa, MP. So coming to his job profile of Dr. Sandeep Chaturvedi, his work involves RF characterization of high frequency active and passive devices and MMICs, measurement automation, MMIC packaging and modeling, design of state-of-the-art MMICs. He has published more than 15 research papers in international journals and conferences, and his research interests include device modeling, packaging, and MMIC design. Dr. Sandeep, sir, we heartily welcome you to this FTP session. Over to you, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Good afternoon and good evening, everyone. I would like to thank Dr. Padmasai Madam, who was instrumental in bringing me on this podium today. Probably today's program, I am like a kind of out of orbit person today, because you've been listening to various experts in artificial intelligence and machine learning. Which is not exactly the area that I work on, but nevertheless, when we talk of communication, whether 1G, 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G, 6G, there has to be finally implemented layer, or the RF layer, and that is the area that we work on. Of course, our work is more related to defense and space segment, wherein we ensure for various kind of communication system, radars or satellite, inter-satellite communication, those systems and the RF hardware that is required for such systems. So I'll probably today's talk, I'll just to keep it very generic for the community.
Sandeep, sir, there is a bandwidth.
Okay, so maybe I can turn off my video. Yeah, I'll turn off my video.
Yeah. Sir.
Video and you can
see. So is it better now?
Yes sir.
I'll try to keep it very very generic today, because I think it will be otherwise completely disorienting the audience what they have learned in last 5 days. So talk to you regarding what we need to do with students who come to the institution, and how do we prepare them for the industry. So that's the theme that I would try to speak on. My expert domain talk, probably we can plan as a separate talk, because for that I need maybe one and a half hours to take you completely through what we exactly do and what applications it covers. So I'll try to do that later, maybe some other event. Today, try to talk about the requirements of institutions for the students. Actually, I'm not getting the sharing option. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, now it is visible, sir.
Yeah, okay. So this is actually the whole talk. Generally, I try to cover the compound semiconductor technologies for high frequency applications. When you say high frequency, you will start from few hundreds of megahertz for basic base station communication and infrastructure requirements, 200 gigahertz or 300 gigahertz for which is in upcoming frequency ranges for the 6G communication. And at GATEC, the place where I work is part of DRDO umbrella. We have been working on compound semiconductor technologies. If you know the semiconductors, you can define them, classify them as elemental semiconductors like silicon, germanium, etc. And then there are compound semiconductors, which are basically made of two elements, like gallium and arsenic makes gallium arsenide, gallium and nitrogen makes gallium nitride, indium phosphide, so on and so forth. So at GATEC, we for last two and a half decades, we have been working on technologies based on compound semiconductors, because this is a niche semiconductor class which has plenty of advantages over the elemental semiconductors, although the competition keeps closing and then separating out with times. With improvement in technology, node sizes, etc., silicon also is has kept moving up the frequency ranges. But there are some specific advantages this compound semiconductor technologies had, and they were very attractive for high frequency communication to start with, especially required for defense and space applications. So this is where I work, and I lead the MMIC design group here, where we design kind of circuits which are required for making such communication systems, transmitters, receivers, up converters, down converters, so all these kind of functions. And recently I have been taken in as a chair of MTT APMC joint chapter Hyderabad section. So this is added responsibility that I'm bearing for last 6 months or so, and that's why I'm here with you today, because IEEE has given me the opportunity to network with people in research, in academia, as well as other industries. So I think many of you know about IEEE. This is world's largest technical and professional organization. And this organization has different societies which are divided based on the engineering areas. Sorry. Engineering areas. So there are about 47 societies depending on okay, and we represent the Microwave Theory and Technique Society, which works on RF circuits, systems, and their implementation. This has been in place for about 60 years. Yeah. Has 10,000 more than 10,000 members and 190 chapters worldwide. This is an all volunteer society. IEEE as such, so nobody goes with a gun after you to work with IEEE. So it's passion that drives us as when we are part of IEEE, and the networking opportunities, knowledge sharing that we can do with each other. So this is what IEEE is about. The MTT APMC joint chapter of Hyderabad section was founded in year 2007. So we are in about 14th year of existence now. And membership is about 200. This is a little old data. So 200 members, which includes students, academicians, research, and industry professionals. And for past 6 months, I have been trying to bring people as much together as possible, because sometimes we feel that being in industry, we are superior. Academicians feel we are better theoreticians, so we are superior. But I'm trying to bridge that gap, so that we talk to each other and then learn from each other, because that's what profession is. And we have about 5 student branch chapters, and I'm expecting that this will grow in the coming years. And I want to see a situation where each and every college in Telangana and Andhra Pradesh has MTT, AP or EMC student branch chapter, and the students, the faculty members can work on niche research areas in RF and microwave. This organization where I work is the only 3-5 semiconductor foundry in production mode. There are some R&D labs like IIC Bangalore, SSPL Delhi, IIT Bombay, etc. But we are the only one who are like into production as a production plant, and we can tape out approximately 300 wafers per annum. It's a small fab that we run, and this is small by design, you know, because it was meant to cater only to the defense and space segment, not to the commercial segment, which is likely to change in, you know, coming time. Because very recently there was a query from the Prime Minister's office that GATEC, having mastered these technologies over the years, can they contribute in 5G, 6G, and automotive sector, which is coming up in big way. So we are you know, looking at that you know, a particular opportunity and the challenges that might come if you go into commercial segments in terms of volumes. And currently we are on a 3-inch fab. That means the wafer on which the circuits are fabricated, it's a 3-inch diameter wafer. And to enter into commercial segment or like 5G, 6G or automotive sector, you need to increase your throughput as well as wafer size. So we have recently proposed an expansion plan for 6-inch wafer line, dedicated 6-inch wafer line, which will be which will allow us to produce more than 10,000 wafers per annum, which is the expected requirement of these added segments. In terms of technology, we have 500 nanometers, 250 nanometers, 130 nanometers, pseudomorphic HEMT-based technology, which can take which can like using which we can make circuits up to 40 gigahertz. So 5G, all the 5G bands from base station segment as well as the handheld segment, MIMO segment, all those can be covered using these technologies. We have the upcoming GaN HEMT technology, which is much superior to silicon, gallium arsenide, everything. And it has a promise of producing very high power densities, typically 4 watts per mm at 28 volts operation and 8 to 10 watts per mm in, at 50 volts operation. So that's what we do. This is a niche facility created by Government of India way back in like mid of 90s, I would say, around 95, 96. And we have supported defense and space segment in big way. Most of the satellites that are flown by ISRO, they carry some or other component that is designed and fabricated at GATEC. So this is our pride. Now coming to point that I wanted to talk today. I will not talk too much technical today because of you know, a different kind of theme of this FTP. So, but I wanted to put one point across to the faculty who are attending this FDP and who are on this call today. What are the areas in RF and microwave technology which have potential for research, which have potential for employment, and you know, probably the institutions, at least higher institutions who have good infrastructure, should try to focus on these technology areas so that they can provide the students the learning environment needed to master these technologies. And you know, what happens when you when you train the students in the technologies which are futuristic, they come prepared into the industry, the absorption is much better. Of course, you know, software segment has a different kind of take altogether, so I will not get into that. But in hardware, you really need to start grooming students from, say, second year of engineering course, so that by the time they complete their undergrad or, you know, postgrad degree, they are ready for the industry. And little bit, you know, these are not like you know, solving some elementary problems and, you know, developing aptitude kind of thing, which is probably good enough for getting into software domain. So that's my it requires a little bit of extended learning. And once that happens, they the student comes out with minimum requirement for the industry and the absorption becomes much better. So the technology areas, broadly, if I have to classify, I can put them in three segments: device circuit design, fabrication and packaging. So that makes the base or core of the RF technology area. Of course, there is a theory that you have to understand and learn behind that, whether it is design, device and circuit design, whether it is fabrication, whether it is packaging and testing or characterizing these devices for a particular application. So this is one area. Then once the devices and components are available, they go into subsystems, right? Using amplifiers, switches, oscillators, mixers, multipliers, all these kind of components, you make subsystems and systems. So subsystems are like, you make a transmitter, you make a receiver, you make a up converter or down converter. And so these are some of the examples of subsystems. And then the systems, which are cohesion of these subsystems. So designing subsystems or systems, integrating them. Now, once you have designed them, you work out the component details, get those components, put them together and see whether it works. Many times it doesn't. So understanding the nitty-gritties of integration and correlating them with the theory that you have developed for that particular system, and then putting such systems in operation. Simply having some components or some discrete idea of a transmitter or a radar doesn't make it happen. So you have to start from the basic concept, how the radar works, what are the subsystems in that, what are the components required to achieve that subsystem, and then how you integrate all these components and subsystems to realize the overall system, and then how, whether it is it works in the way that you have designed it for. So again, a very involved area, and there are theme labs in DRDO which work in subsystem and system design. The examples are the missile complex in Hyderabad, the DLRL, which works on EW segment, electronic warfare segment, then LRD Bangalore, who work on the radars for both, narrowband, mostly in a communication segment. Then you have Defense Application Lab, Dehradun, who work on the satellite communication segment. So like sending and receiving data to satellites for defense applications. So these are the systems that finally evolve. And so, during the education, during the college days, if the students are exposed to these areas, we'll have very high quality manpower that will be ready to serve the industry. And when I say that industry is not limited to DRDO today. Probably it was the case maybe say 10 years or 15 years back, but today there are plenty of players who are in RF segment, and all these are supporting DRDO and ISRO, as well as making their own systems and subsystems which they export to various parts of the world. Then third segment is the sensor element. Now I have got a component, I have designed, fabricated, and qualified it. I made a subsystem or system around that, which functions the way that I wanted it to. But now I have to radiate. I want this, whatever signal I have generated or created, I want this to be transmitted to a far off distance. So this constitutes another big area, which is called antenna technology or sensor elements. So antennas are basically sensors for transmitting as well as receiving the radio waves. So depending on the frequency, depending on the situation that you are in, you define a whole lot variety of antennas, starting from a simple square patch printed on a PCB to very sophisticated horn antennas, metal ridge guide antennas, or array of antennas. So again, it's a very, very big area that is there in the RF domain. One good part out of these three, the antenna technology domain is one which has attracted a lot of interest from academia. The reason being, working in the other two domains requires a lot of infrastructure. If I have to design the circuit or the MMIC, I need a software which costs me worth almost like 15 to 20 lakhs per annum if I have to calculate the annual cost of the software. If I want to fabricate a device, I need to have a fab which requires almost 3 lakh rupees per day as a running expense. I'm not talking of creation of the fab. Creation of fab requires almost 500 crores. So and similar is the subsystems system area. Because unless you have that infrastructure, you cannot work on those areas. But for antenna, it's a very simple thing to start working in. So what you need is like one software, which is nowadays for students, there are softwares like golden standard software, which are freely available for students these days. I'll talk about that. And then you create any design. You just need to print it on a PCB to start with. You can work on PCB-based antennas. So this, I know, starts making things very attractive to work with. And then that's why, you have a lot of people in India, at least, working in antenna technologies compared to the other two areas. And probably, we are working with various government agencies to turn around this situation, wherein like students also probably in coming times will starting to get exposure to the other two areas. They start getting access to these facilities where, at least if not in UG level, at least in PG and research level, they get access to these areas. And they can design and fabricate any kind of innovative component that they want to. In terms of career opportunities, again, it is classified as per these areas. You can become RFIC, MMIC, or component engineer, packaging engineer, test engineer, or you can become a system designer, radar designer, or satellite designer, things like that. Or you can become an antenna designer. So in terms of design, then in terms of fabrication, if you are interested in fabrication aspects, you have to have a little bit of a chemical engineering background to do that. And you can become expert in processing of gallium-ions, these technologies. So those are the areas where you can get employment in this. And on the right side, I have listed some of the potential employers who require students having experience in these three domains or subdomains of these domains, so that they can. Normally, what is happening is I have been in industry for about 20 years now. What happens when we get new recruits? I train them for 2 years, and then the government salaries are not very attractive. After 2 years, they say they are getting a better salary somewhere else. And they pack their bags and go. So many of the government labs have kind of become training centers rather than the users or potential utilizers of these young chaps or young graduates who come in. So we want to point which I want to get across is, If we train students during the degree period, during their undergrad or postgrad education period, they will come to us with some hands-on experience. And then it could be me or it could be any of these industries who work in the RF area. They can start using them almost from the word go. And what happens when you start working, instead of learning for 2 years, if you start working on a real life problem from very, very starting point of your career, that makes you passionate about that area. And then, the attrition of jobs, attrition or switching of jobs becomes lesser of a possibility. And you can grow in that area. You can carry out more research and then do more such good quality work. and then grow further in that area instead of, you know, job hunting from one job to another. So this is, you know, this is something which all the faculty members should probably think and, you know, try to impress upon their students when they go back to the colleges, and then when they are taking colleges, the classes, that students should be oriented to the RF and microwave area. Classically has been a dry area, we call it, because of a little bit of mathematics engagement of mathematics in this. But then as teachers, we are supposed to teach the subject in such a way that we can make this thing interesting for them. And then they, once they get interested, then, you know, the energy that they come up with, the ideas, the bright ideas they can come up with is immense. And then you will see the real potential of the young students. The technology horizon in terms of, industry requirement is what I think you must have learned about this from many speakers during this week. I'm just covering it again. So 5G and beyond is anyway theme of this workshop, where millimeter wave, we are moving to higher and higher frequencies for a certain reason, because, you know, you can have more bandwidth and therefore the high data rate. You can go to further high frequencies in terahertz domain, which is used both for imaging and communication, because terahertz are non-ionizing radiations, and can do very successful imaging using terahertz frequencies. There are already some students working in some of the premier institutes like IITs and IISc in this domain, where they are working on detection of breast cancer or detection of glucose in your body. So online you'll be monitoring that a vital parameter, and then taking the appropriate call about your health and treatment. Internet of Things is another big thing that that has been around and is going to continue to grow with the 5G. It is going to evolve into Internet of Satellites. Currently, we talk to satellite and satellites talk to us back. But then we were very soon going to have the satellites talking to each other. So if I have a constellation of satellites, it is not necessary for me to establish communication from each satellite separately. I can relay the commands between the satellites using this particular concept. Then sensor networks, so these are very important things for perimeter security, for example. So I can, instead of like the cameras, so your cameras are all always visible and they can be tampered with. But if I can make RF sensors which are like small bugs, and then place them at appropriate distances, I can network them together, and then I can bring a complete wireless fencing system. And so this is very important, important area for perimeter security, especially in defense installations where the espionage or terrorist attacks are very common. Then another big area that is coming up with the 5G and 6G probably after that is RF energy harvesting. We have so much of RF energy lying outside, so much of RF being transmitted, but only very small portion of it gets received onto your phone. So there is a lot of free RF energy lying around. And if I can tap that energy and then make use of that into either charging your phone or any powering, any kind of portable system, which cannot always remain connected to a charger, this is a big revolution in this area. So for example, drones, let's say I pack a battery on a drone and it can fly for, let's say, 45 minutes. But if I have a high RF energy harvesting system on at least for smaller drones, then they can keep harvesting the energy from the environment and they can keep going. They never die. So that's the promise of this particular technology. And this is going to go much, much bigger with 5G, because this massive MIMO concept that is coming up, wherein we can have the extraction of RF becomes much easier when you have an array of such extractors sitting on a system. So you have, you know, 16 elements or 64 elements which are receiving, passively receiving, and then quietly converting that received RF power into usable DC energy. Then another big area probably you must have heard of is quantum communication or quantum radar. So this is actually, this is a cross-disciplinary area wherein you must have heard of quantum computing. That means today's computer, they work on binary concept. So you have either zero or one. But quantum computing, the way, if I can trap the particles, and you know, I can in quantum way, I can generate two additional states from that, and that helps me double my, you know, memory retention capacity. So, and the similar kind of concept is extended into radar segment, or wherein, you know, the power that I need to radiate by using quantum entanglement, I can radiate a very low power, because I don't want this RF wave to go hit a target and come back and tell about the target. What I'm doing is I'm generating two particles, entangled in quantum fashion, and I emit one particle. This entangled particle is a twin. It's like a twin in our human race. So whatever the emitted particle faces when it goes and meets the target, this entangled particle replicates its behavior. So instead of waiting for the emitted particle to go hit target and come back, I simply study the behavior of the particle which is sitting home. That means I do not need a very high power to be transmitted. I can have my radar operating with a very low power. What it promises is, since the emitted power is very low, that means the detection possibility of such radars will be very, very low, because radars are detected on their RF power signature. So this is the promise of this upcoming area, and this is going big way in stealth technology. Maybe in next 5 years, 4 or 5 years, you will have most of the fighter aircrafts operating, using these quantum radars, so that they cannot be detected. So the essential skill set, this would be probably last slide I want to talk about. What you need to impart to the students to become useful to these technology areas and the evolution that is happening in these areas is good understanding of the chosen domain. There is obviously absolutely no shortcut for that. So you need to teach them the basics of RF and microwave theory. That is absolute requirement. But apart from that, you also need to impart to them or get them exposed to the tools which can be used. Because, you know, if you talk of a scenario maybe 25 years, 30 years back, all kind of calculations for your design used to be done with a pen and paper. And then very, very primitive tools were available for doing that. But today, we are blessed with advancement in simulation technology. And any kind of system, circuit behavior, finite 3D behavior of a particular object can be studied with simulation. So very high, powerful simulators are available these days. So we need to expose the students to these simulators or simulation tools which are required for this RF and microwave. So some of these are, like, for circuit simulation, you have Keysight Technology Advanced Design System. Then you have the Cadence NI AWR Microwave Office System. These two are the leading tools which are used for circuit simulation. This probably there are some more tools from Cadence, but these two for RF domain, these two are the leading tools which are used by the industry. So if the students learn these tools during their graduate education, it becomes much easier for them to when they come to the industry, they can start working very, very efficiently from beginning itself. Then for system simulation, I talked about system. You want to design a receiver, you want to design a transmitter or a radar. You need to model that system first. If you don't model that, you will never get to realize it better. So for that also, there are plenty of tools available these days. Again, from Keysight, you have System View. From AWR, you have Visual System Simulator. So you in these systems, so what they do is, these systems are MATLAB simulating. What they do is they will have behavioral blocks of various RF components, like an amplifier or a switch or a mixer. So you can design an entire radar or a complete ISA array or a receiver on software first. What kind of gain, what kind of fidelity, what kind of phase coverage, all the dynamic range, all these can be simulated. You can study the modulation effects on the system that you're designing. All these can be done using this software, very powerful ones. And once people understand this, what are the requirements of the system, if I have to achieve certain, let's say when I'm designing a radar, I need to design it for certain RCS. So I can do that beforehand itself. Rather than going building a system and then failing there, so I can do that a priori, and then it basically reduces your number of cycles that you have to go into any system realization. So this is another area that we need to train the students to make them industry ready. Then the third one is the 2.5D, or we call it planar electromagnetic simulation, or a three-dimensional electromagnetic simulation, wherein you study the coupling of various elements with each other, either in planar fashion, which is for integrated circuits, or 3D electromagnetic simulation, where you have 3D electromagnetic objects and coupling of those objects with each other. Each of them is either a radiator or a receiver, right? So how they behave with each other, if you are designing an antenna, how it is going to radiate, if there are some structures around that antenna, how they will impair the performance of the antenna. If you are designing something which is working at a very high frequency, how the signal transitions from a PCB to a connector, or from PCB to a waveguide, and so on and so forth. So these are the some of the simulation tool for circuit simulation. You have Momentum, or there are some more tools like Sonnet, which the students can go through. Then for FEM, for 3D electromagnetic simulation, we use either finite element modeling. Again, there are two streams of this: finite difference time domain and finite integration. So one of those techniques. So there are again very powerful tools from ANSYS, HFSS, high frequency structure simulator, and CST Microwave Studio from CST AG Germany. So these are the tools which are used for electromagnetic simulations, and the students need to learn these tools to be able to design such systems based on which are either 2.5D or three dimensional in nature. Then for calculation, because all RF systems we can design, but somewhere you will require some sort of programming skills also. So the best things are like MATLAB. You can do a lot of coding in MATLAB, and you can mathematically generate modulated signals and things like that. Analyze the received signals using that, and Python. So these two are another other two essential tools in terms of mathematics, RF systems, and received signals, which need to be told up. And then when somebody is working into hardware, the ultimate thing in design cycle is characterizing your hardware that you have built. So if it is possible, I know that possessing these instruments is not easy thing, because these are very costly equipments. like each single equipment costing more than 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs. But if you can generate some funds, or you can get some projects from where these fund instruments can be sourced, the students should get an exposure to these instruments for network analysis, which is like generated, either it could be a S parameter network or jet parameter network, etc., etc. Spectrum analysis for all kind of radar hardware, you need to study the spectrum, or you know, when I say spectrum, it's only magnitude. When I say signal, it's both magnitude and phase. So these instrument, then synthesized sources, function generators, oscilloscopes, etc. So if they get even a little bit of exposure to these hardware instruments, when they go out into the industry, they will not require somebody to teach them for 6 months or a year to use these instruments. Because you know, sometimes what happened, this is a practical case where like when I joined, and my senior said, okay, see, you just watch from a distance, do not touch this equipment, this is very costly. So this kind of scenario will not happen if the student has already laid hands on such equipments in college itself, right? So we want, the industry expects their students to come ready with some basic skill set. And these are some of them. So this is what I would just end with.
Sandeep sir, definitely we'll invite one more time.
Definitely, that is what. So this is what I wanted to talk today. And then maybe, you know, we can have a dedicated session where I can actually take you through the, you know, the essentials of the RF area. I can talk about all, you know, from device to circuit to subsystem, at least these three areas I can cover in very great detail. So with this, I would like to thank the organizer of this particular FDP, and in particular, Dr. Padma Sai Madam, and the director, Mr. Chennakesava Rao, then Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who is EC head here. I would like to thank all of you for being able to organize such a wonderful program where you have engaged with the faculty across, I think, across the whole state to learn about this upcoming technology, which is like 5G and beyond. And I know the increasing use of artificial intelligence in these technologies. I'm sure the speakers would have done justice to the theme of this workshop. I started interacting with Madam when she approached me for suggesting some speakers. So, you know, although it is not my expertise area, I thought maybe let me try the network available to me, and so that, you know, I can help this particular theme and this initiative taken by them. So I would like to end with this, and thank you very much for inviting me. And probably we can interact in much greater detail when it comes to my subject area, my expertise area.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Sandeep, sir. It has been indeed a great privilege to have you here on this platform. And definitely we'll look forward for your guidance also, wherein we are also a set of microwave people available in the department who would like to have your guidance, especially in the establishment of IEEE MTT student chapter, as well as for the MTech defense technology, wherein a lot of courses are basically oriented on microwave engineering, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing your time and being a part of this FDP. Now, I would like all the participants to please switch on their videos so that we can take a group photo before we proceed for the concluding remarks. And I would like the participants, at least a few participants, who can just give their feedback during this process when you switch on your videos. Please, we would like to hear out from you also regarding this FDP. So any of the participants, those who are joined this session, so please speak out about what are the takeaway points at least from the FDP or anything which you would like us to improve on from that perspective. So I would like the participants to please switch on their videos.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
Madam, I am Dr. Rajshekar from Associate Professor, Pace Institute of Science and Technology from Ongole, Madam. Okay.
Okay.
So I'm very much happy about attending for this FDP. Okay, but all the lectures were handled by the fourth most experts, like from IITs, NEXT, and NITs, and especially from industries also, like NetSim, MathWorks, and in fact, this FDP is a futuristic and a full research perspective for that could be helpful for the for continue the researches, current researches, next and doctorates for further continue in the machine learning, next and deep learning in the 5G and 6G communications along with. And the fourth most added advantage of this FDP is hands-on sessions and providing the YouTube links and hassle-free updates through the WhatsApp, but really helpful. But my special thank you, Dr. Chalapathirao sir, for making me to participate in this workshop. And even in-house from VNR Vignan Jyoti College, in-house lectures also very nice. And I'm very much thankful for all the coordinators and organizers. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Rajshekar sir. Thank you for those nice words for us. So anyone else would like to speak regarding the FDP? So any kind of feedback, we would love to take that back. So any of the FDP participants, so please go ahead. You can unmute yourself and give your feedback regarding the FDP sessions, whatever you have attended. Chalapathirao sir, are we done with the photo, sir?
Okay, madam.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So since we have done with the feedback, so hope we'll continue with the next part. So I would like to have some concluding remarks from Dr. Chennakesarao sir, our Director for Advancement and Dean Admin, VNR VGIT. Sir.
Good evening, madam. Respected dignitaries on the screen and my dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to congratulate the department for organizing this 1 week faculty development program on challenges in adapting machine learning towards 5G and 6G communication systems. So on behalf of VNR VGIT and my own behalf, I once again thank all the dignitaries, especially the experts who have delivered the lectures during the last 1 week. And at the same time, I also thank all the participants. I think without their support also, it is not possible to organize any event successfully. So I once again thank all of you for sparing your valuable time and attending this 1 week faculty development program. I also thank AICT. So you have come forward to support financially and as well as awarding this FDP program to VNR VGIT. So in this connection, I would like to thank Dr. Venkat Garu for your wholehearted support in giving support, financial support for this 1 week program. I also thank Padmasai Madam and Rajiv Prasad and Chalapathirao Garu, who is the backbone of this faculty development program, and all the faculty members, Ramohan Reddy and Kansuda Madam and Joshna Madam, all the members who were involved in conducting this FDP successfully. I would like to compliment the department and all the faculty and students and ex-students for successful completion of this 1 week faculty development program. So at the end, I think I would like to request all the participants, I think whatever the information that you have gained during this particular 1 week faculty development program, please try to share with your fellow friends and see that this whatever the knowledge that you have gained during this particular 1 week should be informed to all other faculty colleagues also. Okay, that is our objective actually. And the second one is, I think this is the one type of networking I think we are creating. And naturally, whenever you have any difficulty, whenever you have any problems regarding these areas, I think you can always contact us, so that definitely our department will help you in solving your problems also. I wish you all good luck. All the best once again. Thank you very much for sparing your valuable time. Thank you, madam. Over to Constable.
Yes. Thank you, sir. So next, I would like to hear from Dr. Y. Padmasai, ma'am, Dean Student Progression, VNR VJIT. Ma'am.
Thank you, Kanti. Actually, first of all, I would like to thank all the participants for troubling from morning 9:30 to 5. Actually, when we planned according to ACT, we have to plan only 14 sessions. When we contacted, all eminent speakers came forward to give talk. So because of that one, even though it is hectic, we have scheduled extra sessions. So first of all, I would thank all the participants for traveling, for patience listening of this event. We have posted all the sessions in YouTube channel. Whenever you are finding time, I request all of you, please go through those links. Actually, all the speakers, they have given a lot of scope to further do your research in that area. So I would like to thank all the speakers. Actually, they have, even though each one, if you name from starting to ending, they are very busy with their schedules. Even though they are that much busy, they are able to spend their valuable time for us. So I would like to thank all of them for making this event wonderful. Last but not least, I would like to thank all my colleagues. Without their support, it is not possible to complete. I want to thank each one of you and our management, principal, and director, and all of them for making this event successful. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for those words. Next, I would like to invite Rajendra Prasad, sir, head of the department, EC, to speak a few.
Madam, I'm meeting.
Rajendra Prasad, sir.
Yeah, good evening, one and all. Yeah, good evening, one and all. The theme of this FDP seems to be a very good topic for selection for school for research. This involves, I think, two latest technologies like 5G and 6G, as well as machine learning. So combining these two has a lot of scope for research. So that's where I hope all the participants have benefited or at least got some insights from this, so that they can carry forward their research in this field. In this way, I thank all the resource persons for accepting. In fact, we identified a good resource persons and thank for them, since they have accepted our invitation and delivered their knowledge and shared their knowledge to all these participants. So even today, guests like Ratnakar sir and Sandeep sir, even they are also related to core these topics. So in that way, we are very happy, sir. Somehow we are able to identify and at least we accepted all our requests. For that, I thank Padmasai madam and Charvatra sir and other colleagues who identified all these good resource persons. And also I thank our management and principal sir, director sir, and Padmasai madam for encouraging our department to conduct these many type of FDPs or other programs. And finally, I thank even Charvatra sir, Kansula madam, and other team members for successfully conducting this event. And thank you all for that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So next, I would like to invite Chalpatra, sir, the coordinator of this FTP. Chalpatra, sir, a few words from you. Chalpatra, sir.
Sir, I might.
Yes, yes. Yeah. Respected dignitaries, colleagues, and dear participants, good evening to all. First of all, I would like to thank AICT Training and Learning Academy for giving me this opportunity to organizing this 5-day online FDP on challenges in adapting machine learning towards 5G and 6G communications. So next, I would like to thank today's state guests, Ratnakar Rao sir and Sandeep sir, for joining us in your busy schedule and sharing your wonderful thoughts in the field of communications. We are happy to be with you, sir. I hope your presence will be with us forever like this in the coming days. Thank you very much, sir. And I also thank our resource persons from day 1 to day 2, day 5, to sharing their insights and wisdom with all of us. I extended my gratitude to the respected management, VNR Vijnana Jyoti, Principal Sir, Director Sir, Dean, Students Progression, and HOD for guidance and support. And last but not the least, this event would not have been successful without the participation of a wonderful audience. We thank you all for being with us these 5 days, for your sincere and successful participation in this faculty development program. And my deep sense of appreciation to the organizing committee members for all their efforts without interrupting the entire program and making this FDP as a grand success. Finally, I would like to inform you, all the participants, to complete the assessment test by today before 10 p.m. This test requires 60% of minimum marks, and you must share your valuable feedback in the ATAL portal only. After that, you will get the certificate from ATAL. Thank you very much to one and all.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that greeting, sir. Your vote of thanks. And also, I would like to thank all the people who are part of this organizing committee, especially starting with Padma Sai ma'am, who happens to be the chair, and Rajendra Prasad sir, our head of the department, who has given us immense amount of support, followed by Santosh Kumar sir, Archana ma'am, Josna ma'am, Kalyan, Sangeeta ma'am, Deepti, Srinivasrao sir, Pradeep, Shravant, and Ramya, and a lot of other members who are part of our communications group also have helped us in the background. And we are all led by Chalpatra sir, the coordinator of this FTP, in conducting this, and hope we have given you a very good experience. And I would like to thank on this occasion all the chief guests who are present during the inaugural session, and as well as our management, who has been very much supportive for conducting such kind of sessions. Thank you, one and all. And I do hope that we'll continue our learning process, and happy Independence Day to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.